after the withdrawals. Novak Djokovic serving first, and he starts his 18th Australian Open with an ace, and his first appearance here in Melbourne for 2 years, having been deported on the eve of the championships last year. But remember, he is very much the man to beat. The champion in 2019 when he beat Rafael Nadal, the champion in 2020 when he beat Dominic Thiem, and the champion again in 2021 when he beat Daniil Medvedev. The second time he's won three in a row. And of course, this wouldn't be four in a row because of his absence last year, but it would feel like four in a row for him if he's able to win the title at the end of the fortnight. He's putting a backhand into the net there, and he's level at 15 all in this opening game with Roberto Carballes Baena, the world number 75 from Spain. 29 years of age, 6 foot tall, from Tenerife, to be precise. A man who doesn't have a great Grand Slam record. He's lost in the first round in 11 of his last 19 Grand Slam appearances. Djokovic in blue, two different tones of blue, his top and his shorts. And what is very visible, as Gigi was saying, is that fairly obvious white strapping above the knee on his left leg. Djokovic serving again, a second service, a forehand to the backhand of Carballes Baena. Djokovic lifts the backhand to the double-handed backhand of the Spaniard. Djokovic onto the sideline, a slice backhand now from the nine-time champion here in Melbourne. A backhand cross-court from Djokovic. Now he's got the short ball and he makes no mistake. The forehand down the line is a winner. Goran Ivanisevic's coach nods approvingly.
As does Mr. and Mrs. Djokovic. Sergin and Diana, I bumped into them a little earlier. I haven't seen them for a number of years, and it was nice to see them. Unusual to see his mother and father here at the beginning of the tournament. They usually arrive, what would you say, middle of the tournament, when they do come to the slams these days.
Good hitting by Djokovic, and it's long, very much on the back foot by Carballes Baena. I think they joined us via Zoom last year. I think they were part of a press conference about 4 or 5 days before
yes,
the final hearing.
True. Yeah,
it was a attempt to
swing.
Yeah, maybe swing the judges' opinion, as a service winner gives Djokovic the opening game to 15, but certainly to try and show their support for their son, who, whatever your view on the situation, was going through a pretty stressful and unpleasant experience. But I don't hold any grudges, he said when he arrived in Adelaide, to give one interview to Channel 9 in which he said he felt as if he was painted as the villain of the world. And he was really pointing his finger at the world's media there. I did ask him in his news conference on Saturday afternoon whether he still felt he was being portrayed as the villain. And he said, nope, that was specifically last year. And again, he said it was certain media organisations, and he doesn't feel like the villain anymore. Which is a diplomatic answer.
Exactly. I think it was a wise move for him to come to Adelaide. That's my hometown, and he is also familiar with Adelaide. He used to come when he was still, well, an aspiring pro. I'm not sure that he had much of a ranking when he first came to Adelaide, but he was welcomed very, very warmly there, and fond memories, walks away with a title on top of it.
He's won the first game, and here is Carballes Baena missing his first serve. He has a mostly white top with some blue, especially underneath the armpits, some blue shorts, and he's serving right in front of us, as I said. We're watching, he's watching, a slice backhand from Djokovic, a backhand cross-court from Carballes Baena, and a slice backhand into the net by the serve. Well, I think we can drop the Baena, can't we, in that Spaniards often use the first of their two surnames.
Yep. Are we okay going with RCB even?
Well, there's RCB, there's PCB, there's ARV. Who have I missed out?
RBA.
RBA, yeah.
BVDZ.
Botic van der Zandskulp, inspired. Maybe he's got some Spanish roots. Forehand cross court by Djokovic. The forehand from Carballes. He's having to reach very hard to hit this forehand, and the backhand from Djokovic this time, too powerful, hitting in behind the Spaniard, and already with a bit to think about on serve at 15-all.
Yeah, already in the game and a half, each time that the Spaniard has just mishit the ball, he's lost the pace of shot, the weight on his ground play. Djokovic has smothered the ball into the corner, and it must be distressing for the Spaniard. He hasn't been able to read some of the shots of Novak already.
15-all, second serve from Carballes. Nice looking backhand return by Djokovic, and that is right onto the baseline by Carballes, his best shot of this match so far. You would think he's on a hiding to nothing in this match if Novak Djokovic is fully fit. There is just a massive gulf between these two players on the Grand Slam stage, and Carballes is much, much happier on a clay court. It would seem like one of the most improbable upsets in Australian Open history, really, wouldn't it? Assuming Novak Djokovic is fit. But you just never know. Backhand wide by Djokovic.
Yes, just having a look at his career record here at the Australian Open. He's only won two matches in the seven appearances here in Melbourne.
Then again, we remember, do we not, Dennis Istomin beating Novak Djokovic in the second round in 2017. Service winner from Carballes, one game all. That was a huge shot. Djokovic was two sets to one up, but ultimately lost in five sets in 4 hours and 50 minutes to the world number 117, I think he was. He'd won the Asia-Pacific Wildcard Challenge in China, Istomin, just to get into the main draw.
Well, big game. It's just thinking about Istomin, the way that he, you know, goes about his tennis. It's, you know, he has that ability to win points. I'm not sure that...
Serving and volleying here, Djokovic, with a bit of work to do still, and Carballes has won the point. Excellent defence and a backhand down the line winner for the Spaniard.
Well, talk about winning a point. That was a fantastic return of serve. He just got his racket onto the ball, Carballes, and been able to find the open court with a backhand pass up the line.
Backhand return from him. Djokovic hits the backhand. Carballes with the forehand. Djokovic cross court with the backhand. Forehand now from Djokovic. Eyes lighting up there. Carballes just dropping a little bit short. And Djokovic with absolute precision. A forehand into the corner here on tennis breakfast, if we may still call it that at this time of the morning. 11:45 in the UK. Mark Woodford here alongside me, Russell Fuller, on BBC Sounds. Five Sports Extra. Good serve here by Djokovic, and just into the net by Carballes, who showed elastic arms to just block that ball back, but not quite able to block it back over the net. So last year on tour, he reached three quarterfinals, Carballes Baena, all on clay, and played on the Challenge Tour, won a couple of challenges on clay in Tunis and Seville. And most of his tour level wins have been on that surface. Here's Djokovic on the attack, underneath the high ball, the smash, straight back at Carballes Baena, the volley from Djokovic, the lob from Carballes Baena, the backhand volley from Djokovic, and cross court and wide goes Carballes. But we're seeing some nice rallies in the early stages. Certainly Djokovic not totally dictating at this stage.
And in this game, of the 4 points, three, we've seen Novak up at net.
...40-15 Djokovic. Another good serve out wide. Brilliantly reached by Carbajas, and he's stretching again for this forehand. Backhand now from Carbajas into the net, but unlucky. Really showing his athleticism there, but unable to prevent Djokovic moving into a 2-1 lead. So 75 tour level wins for Carbajas Baena, 57 of those on clay, 17 on hard courts, and I meant to look up who he beat. One on grass. Mark Woodford, what's the world coming to? One win on grass in his entire career.
It must have been a very slow grass court. And high bouncing, one would assume, as well. I think that's why we've seen already Djokovic throw in that backhand slice just to change it up, try to get the ball out of the strike zone of Carbajas Baena.
Three holes of serve so far. Just looking at his Wimbledon record to see if the grass court win came there. No, it didn't. He's never managed to win a match at Wimbledon. But there are a lot of players who don't attract too many headlines, but they earn a very good living for themselves by working phenomenally hard, traveling the world, playing on the surfaces on which they are most comfortable. So in the case of Carbajas Baena, you can go and play in South America on the clay in February.
Exactly, and that's exactly what he does. I was looking at his ranking throughout 2022, and he maintained the level between 70 and 75, probably for at least 7 months of the year. He did drop down to 90, maybe close to 100, but there was a result that helped bump him back up to his position, or close to his highest, which was 71, November of 21, when he hit that career high. But as you say, four challenger titles in the finals this year. Oh, sorry, I should say in 2022. So he's not short of match practice.
59. He's won the first point on serve here. He trails 1-2, but we're going with serve in the very, very early stages. Down the tee towards the forehand of Novak Djokovic, but that serve was long. Aha, I found it. Backhand reply from Djokovic cross court. Backhand Djokovic down the line, just skimming the take. Forehand from Carbajas hit with power cross court, and now down the line he goes. He's got Djokovic on the run, and we know how quick he is, but didn't quite get there in time. So some excellent hitting by Carbajas Baena to move to 30 love.
So the victory came.
It came in Turkey against J.C. Aragone, who at the time was the world number 552. And that was in the first round of the Antalya grass court event of 2019. Aced by Carbajas Baena. And he won 6-4, 7-6. And then very nearly beat a very fine grass court player, Adrian Mannarino, in the next round, losing 7-5 in the decider.
I have a feeling that might have been the same year that Yuichi Sugita won that particular event.
Well, that is exceptional knowledge.
From memory, I think it might have been.
Which Japanese player won the grass court event in Antalya, Turkey in June of 2019? I think that'd be a pointless answer for many people. Backhand reply cross court by Djokovic, really well struck. Now he's coming in and hitting the drive volley, and the lob is wide by Carbajas. So he is still to close out this game at 40-15.
Nice drive volley by Djokovic there to take time away from his opponent. And once again, we're just seeing a trend in this early stage of Novak bullying his way to net.
Forty-15. He has won one ATP title, Cabo Espaillena. No prizes for guessing on which surface. Forehand from Djokovic. Slice backhand from the nine-time Australian Open champion, the former world number one, as he is for the moment. The backhand by Djokovic down the centre. Carbajas with a forehand, dropping a little bit short. Djokovic goes very deep, right on the baseline, Djokovic, and no nonsense at all. That forehand cross-court is just too deep, too deadly. And a little bit of pressure on the server now at 40-30.
14 strikes in that last rally, finishing with Djokovic's forehand. Just able to spread Carbajas into that forehand court, the juice court.
Aurélie Tort of France is our umpire for this match. The last first round match to begin on the Rod Laver Arena. I'm not sure every single match that was on the schedule today has actually begun yet. I'm not aware of them sending any players home either. Trying to get everything done, and if it stays dry, they can under the floodlights. Forehand, aggressive one from Carbo Espaillena. The defensive lob from Novak Djokovic, buying himself a little bit of time. Bounce bash from Carbo. Back to Djokovic, another lob, a better one by Djokovic, and he's won the point. Because Carbo has framed what was a much trickier smash.
Strong support, vocal support behind the Serb. Plenty of flags in the crowd.
Carbajas down the middle, just missing that first serve. Second serve at juice onto the backhand of Djokovic. Backhand cross court wide. Here's the first break point of the match, and you're never safe, are you, when Novak Djokovic is the returner, even as a server at 40 love.
Yeah, it's a difficult choice of when you are the server. It's a big point. You're trying to send it, the serve down to arguably one of the all-time great returners. Do you go to his forehand side or the backhand?
Ace from Carbajas. Break point saved.
Well, he found the answer there. Has to hit it flush on the line to get it past the racket of Djokovic.
And past the Djokovic forehand on this occasion. Juice, forehand return. Djokovic slips slightly, but he's up as quick as a flash and now slicing a backhand from the baseline. Slice backhand, hit by Djokovic down the very center of this blue court, but that's a rare error from the 35-year-old, and it's another opportunity for Carbo Espaillena to close out this game. ...25 seconds allowed between points for the players. We have a countdown clock, which is something you will see everywhere you go on the tennis tour, at least at the main tour level. Excellent serve by Carbajas. Great stretch by Djokovic to prolong the point, but only very briefly, because there's Carbajas putting a forehand down the line, winning the point, taking the game, saving the break point, two games all. And I was just wondering what Novak Djokovic was saying to his players box there. He was just rotating his right wrist.
Yeah, I believe it might. Well, my guess, Russell, is about the serve from the Spaniard, that perhaps they were expecting it to be a flatter serve, but he's actually swinging quite a few of these second serves. And when you swing it on a faster court, generally in the evenings, the court plays a little quicker.
Forehand from Djokovic, it's two games all. It's the serve serving again. He has to drive volley, happy to come forward once again. Now he's pedaling back, he's underneath the smash. Forehand hit by Djokovic, backhand Carbo Espaillena. Backhand Djokovic, he's missed. And this is good, solid resistance. I know we've only played four games, but Carbo Espaillena has certainly made a promising start to this match. We hope it's going to be competitive. And I said it's one of the more unlikely upsets in Australian Open history. I'd stick by that because right. of the record that we've been describing. But he's certainly going about it the right way at the moment.
Besides the fact that he has not beaten a top 10 player. I'm not sure if that's a stat that you'd throw in at all. 0-9 against top 10 is Cabellos Baena.
But he has Djokovic here at love 15. He's forced Djokovic to miss a first serve. Backhand Djokovic into the net. So, a couple of mistakes there. And suddenly love 30 down. And what we genuinely do not know is whether this hamstring is a major concern for Djokovic. If it's tightening up occasionally and he thinks he can manage it, which is what he's been indicating so far, then no great drama. But of course, over the course of a five-set match or a two-week Grand Slam, these conditions can deteriorate. Forehand return from the Spaniard, who has love 30 on the Djokovic serve. Backhand from Carbeas, landing this one on the baseline, and Djokovic has gone wide with the forehand. That was fantastic hitting from Carbeas Baena, and having saved a break point, he now has three break points of his own. Love 40 down, first serve into the net by Djokovic. Second serve, down the tee, a big one, and the forehand follow-up by Djokovic is really aggressive, and it opens up the court for the forehand cross-court angled volley.
A big second serve delivery, 189. On the speed clock, and perhaps catching his opponent by surprise.
Judging by his facial reaction, yes, exactly that. So, break point number two, well directed serve out wide to the forehand of Carbeas Baena, and that also opens up the court. The 1-2 punch coming in behind the serve and putting the off forehand away into the empty court, and that's two of three break points saved by Djokovic on his 18th appearance here in Melbourne, if you don't include last year's appearance in front of the family court. Judge Anthony Kelly. I wonder what he's doing this year. Forehand return by Carbeas, who still has a break point here, the third of the game. Forehand Carbeas down the line. He's got Djokovic in a rally at last here. Forehand from the Spaniard, dropping a little bit short. Another forehand from him over the baseline. Djokovic wins 3 points in a row to save all three break points.
And wonderful use of the court, the geography of the court. Once more we see Carbeas, when he loses the weight of shot, it just opens the door for Djokovic to motor his way. He doesn't find the depth in the court, he certainly finds an angle. Back to Juice.
Two games all. Juice, entertaining start to this match. Carbeas onto the forehand of Djokovic. Backhand from Carbeas. Djokovic with the backhand. Both hitting very, very deep. Carbeas getting closer and closer to the baseline, but finding the line. Forehand Djokovic. Carbeas with a forehand. Djokovic with a forehand. Carbeas with a forehand, which is finally long, but good aggressive hitting by the Spaniard. Yeah, you live by the sword, sometimes you die by the sword. And it's now game point Djokovic for 3-2. We'll get some scores from Gigi, I think, if we can in a moment, at the change of ends. See what else is happening elsewhere. There's a good serve by Djokovic. Now the drive volley. The backhand from Carbeas Baena. He's hit it straight back at Djokovic. Backhand from Carbeas is just the wrong side of the baseline. And so Djokovic from love 40 down holds and leads by 3-2 after 25 minutes of this first round match at 2 minutes past 11 in Melbourne. Are you there, Gigi? No, she's not. Worth asking the question every now and again. Casper Ruud, 6-3. He's won the first set against Tomáš Macek of the Czech Republic. That's being played on the Margaret Court Arena. 5-4 on serve Macek in the second. There's another match in progress on the John Cain Arena. And at the moment, that one's fairly close. Tseng of Taiwan has won the first set 6-4 against Alexei Popperin, the Australian wildcard, and actually has a set point at the moment to go 2-0 in front. Tanasi Kokkinakis has won the first 2 sets against Fabio Fognini, 6-1, 6-2. They're in the early stages of the third. John Isner has won the first set on a tiebreak against Adrian Mannarino by 7-5. Roberto Bautista Agut, RBA, 4-1 up on João Sousa of Portugal in the first set. And that's probably about it for now. Novak Djokovic coming back from a swift bathroom break.
Was quickly darted off after winning that game from love 40. Blink of an eye. Certainly up ready for this next game as well.
So the 3 break points have been squandered, or more accurately saved, by Novak Djokovic, and it's Roberto Carvalho Baena, the world number 75, who's serving now from the commentary box end. First serve into the net, second serve onto the backhand of Djokovic. Forehand Djokovic cross court, the forehand from Carvalho, and now his backhand. Djokovic down the line with the backhand. Good defense by Carvalho with the backhand, and now reaching for a forehand. He really is a terrific athlete. He's stretching every sinew. He's running down a lot of balls, and he's keeping Novak Djokovic very honest in the early stages. But that's a brilliant backhand by Carvalho, which again, by Djokovic, I should say, sorry, which Carvalho gets a racket to, but no control on that. And Djokovic eventually wears them down and wins the point.
Big hitting in that particular point, Russell. I think some other players might have lost that point a lot sooner than what Carvalho Baena did.
Love 15. Carvalho to the forehand of Djokovic. Forehand from Carvalho. Djokovic with the forehand. Backhand, this rally down the centre of the court for now, until Carvalho swings his backhand cross court, once again targeting the Djokovic backhand. A little bit of luck from the net, Carvalho, as he stays in this rally. Forehand down the line, Djokovic, wonderfully struck.
Effortless power off the forehand wing. Not a bad depth of shot from Carvalho. It was Djokovic's forehand, that crisp, clean, and now love 30.
And a serve into the net. Love 30, second serve. Oh, a double fault.
We are, again, well positioned, Russell. I think for the view of Carvalho's serve, I would expect on clay, having seen him play a number of times on that surface, that usually the second serve is a heavy kick. But tonight he has been trying to come around the outside of the ball. Doesn't give him a lot of margin over the net.
3 break points for Djokovic. Forehand Carvalho. Backhand hit by the Spaniard to the slice backhand of the Serb. Forehand from Djokovic, hitting to the backhand of Carbeas Baena. Cross court goes Carbeas. He's got a forehand now, which is landing a little bit short. He's going to have to show all his athleticism to get out of jail here and hold his serve. Slice backhand from Carbeas. Djokovic cross court with the backhand. Carbeas is working his way back into this rally, reaching for backhand. This is sitting up rather for Djokovic. And that was gift wrapped. Great resistance by Carbeas Baena for some time in that rally, but the three break points, too many against a man like Djokovic. He's taken the first one of them, and having saved three break points of his own, his fans are singing inside the Rod Laver Arena. He leads by 4-2.
Oh, that was a heavy rally, 24 shots, and Djokovic finally working his way inside the court to put the final forehand away. Not a bad game by Carbeas. Besides the one double fault, it was winning shots by Djokovic.
4-2 Djokovic. The winner of this match will play either the French qualifier Enzo Cuaco or Hugo Delian of Bolivia. That is one of a handful of matches which actually has been postponed until tomorrow. Backhand Djokovic, forehand from Carbeas Baena. Now the Spaniard reaching for a backhand. Djokovic looks like he has him on toast here, and it's a forehand error that ends the rally. It comes from the racket of the 29-year-old from Tenerife. So instead of going out at 11 o'clock or so in the evening, they've opted to come back tomorrow. Cuaco and Delian. Other players who've been sent home include Meir Sharif of Egypt, Sloane Stephens, the former US Open champion, Tatiana Maria, who reached the semi-finals of Wimbledon last year, and Richard Gasquet as well. He just started his match with Hugo Humbert, and it looks like that one has been postponed until tomorrow. Daria Kasatkina, one of the top seeds. Beatriz Haddad-Meyer, the WTA's most improved player last year. Good serving by Djokovic. The return into the net by Carbeas Baena. So Djokovic 4-2, 30 love. So a slightly more packed schedule tomorrow. Half the singles players would normally be out at the end of 2 days. So fewer matches to schedule. But Wednesday is also the day, as Mark Woodford knows very well, where we see the doubles players for the first time. So it will be a heavy old schedule again, and showers are forecast. In fact, I think there could be quite a lot of rain round during the daytime at least. Good serve by Djokovic. Service winner, 40 love, 3 game points. This to move into a 5-2 lead. Good serve. High forehand return by Carbeas, and the aggressive drive volley by Djokovic. Can't make the drop shot though. He certainly seems to be trying quite a few things out. He's been quite creative out there, isn't he? Looks like he's prepared to experiment a little bit to hone his game, I suppose, for what he expects will be tougher challenges to come.
Well, this is the time to do it, isn't it? To have that freedom to maybe transition towards the net. Seen that frequently. There was almost another serve and volley point.
40-15 Djokovic. Missed the first serve. Second serve is to double fault. So the one ATP title that Carbeas Baena won was on clay in Quito in Ecuador in 2018, which you may be aware is at altitude. And it says on his ATP players page that actually, having grown up in Granada, he really enjoys playing at altitude. And I didn't know that Granada was 738 meters above sea level.
Wow.
Nothing like Ecuador and Colombia, certain parts of it and places like that, but one of the reasons he performs so well there as a service winner by Djokovic moves him into a 5-2 lead. So looking good. If the hamstring was going to trouble him, it's likely to become more apparent, I suppose, in the latter stages of the match.
when that bit of fatigue, potentially, just seemed like at the start of this match that he was aware of it and slightly cautious, but he certainly amped up his play over the last 2.5 games.
Looks to be moving well, certainly striking the ball well. The exhibition match against Nick Kyrgios on the Rod Laver Arena last Friday night, even though they played a couple of first to four game sets.
Oh, that was going to be my question.
It's got to help, hasn't it?
What was the format there?
Fast four.
Okay.
So they played that. It was predictably one set all. And then they played a 10-point match tiebreak. And they were joined by some wheelchair players and some junior players. And I think Team Kyrgios won in the end.
Ah, okay.
By the odd point. Did you have a problem with them playing that match? Because Mr. Patrick Cash was very, very agitated by the fact that those two got a chance to play on the Rod Laver Arena in front of 15,000 pounds, just there, 15,000 people, just 3 days before a Grand Slam.
I think Cashy, you know, making that statement, I mean, the other three slams, they don't hold a one-match exhibition for players. And I think the response has been somewhat mixed. There are a general response I've heard is, well, the players are practicing during the day. The courts are in use during the day by anyone that makes a booking. So this was just a night booking.
I didn't have a problem with it. As Djokovic nets with a forehand into the advertiser's sign on the net, which is where you heard a rather clunky noise just then. It's Roberto Carballes-Baena serving to stay in the set. He is 2-5 down, but he has 15 love. Good hitting by Djokovic on the backhand. That's not coming back. I just think, irrespective of the fact that we're not going to see Nick Kyrgios here at all this fortnight, other than on that one appearance, I just think Tennis Australia personally did the right thing. That there are occasions where Novak Djokovic is the man of the moment in that he's coming back.
Yes.
But so too was Nick Kyrgios. A lot of excitement about him. And they sold 15,000 tickets. A lot of the money went to charity. It was on nationwide television in Australia as Carballes goes down the line and hits a forehand winner. And that's got to be good for the sport. And I don't think it distorts the level playing field. I don't think it makes for an unfair competition.
No, no, not at all. If we were talking about grass, where, you know, they're trying to keep the court in top condition, not allowing other players to perhaps get a crack onto the court. Different here on RL8.
Excellent serve by Carballes. Djokovic can't control the backhand return. Looking like he's going to extend this set by at least another game. But then he did throw away a 40 love position not too long ago, nearly got broken, and then eventually was broken in the next service game. Backhand slice by Djokovic, skims the top of the net, and the error from Carballes-Baena, wide with the forehand down the line, passing attempt.
The times I have seen Carballes play his matches, and quite often, Russell, there have been on the clay surface, and you know your work rate is higher on the clay, extended rallies, but boy, he must go through his tennis gear, because each time I see him he is absolutely saturated.
He puts in a fantastic shift, and that's a good serve down the middle which secures the game for him. So 5-3 now Djokovic. He has a chance to serve out this first set. It's quite a bit cooler now, but by normal standards, 22 degrees at 11 o'clock in the evening and still quite a lot of humidity would be quite unpleasant. It's just 15 degrees cooler than it was about 6 hours ago.
And don't forget, there was a time when Novak struggled in those changing conditions and never overly comfortable in humid weather.
Five, three. Djokovic leads. He has the first point of the game he needs to close out the first set as Carbajas puts a forehand into the net. This phenomenal winning streak in Australia. 21 matches in a row at the Australian Open, having won the title on the last three occasions he's been allowed to play. And it's 34 in total in Australia, because you need to throw in the wins for Serbia in two editions of the ATP Cup and his run to the Adelaide title in the first week of the year. Backhand hit by Djokovic cross court. Backhand by Carbajas. Backhand down the line, Carbajas. Djokovic had to move pretty quickly to run that one down, but he's done it with a little bit of room to spare. More great hitting from Djokovic. And even though Carbajas is getting to virtually every ball, just not in a position to do anything with that backhand, he nets, and Novak Djokovic is now 2 points away from taking the first set in his comeback match at the Australian Open.
And that's a dominating record that you had run through, Russell, before that previous point. He is at home on the courts here in Australia.
Rafa Nadal has 14 French Open titles. Margaret Court has 11 Australian Open titles. He's chasing those two now in terms of titles won at any particular Grand Slam. Off forehand winner by Djokovic. Martina Navratilova won 9 Wimbledons in the singles. So they'd be in joint third in that particular list. And that forehand has brought up 3 set points for Djokovic. 5-3, 40 love. Did have to come back from love 40 down at 2-all. But he's pulled away from Carbajas Baena since saving those break points. 1 or 2. Prematurely celebrating a first set for Djokovic there, but that was a let.
Well, it's like the alarm clock went off at 2 games apiece and love 40 down.
5-3, 40 love, and an ace down the tee by Djokovic. And that was a very nice return to the Rod Laver Arena and the competitive capacity to Melbourne Park. He was given plenty to think about in the early stages there by Roberto Carbajas, but Djokovic has taken the first set in 42 minutes by 6-3. 20 past 11 here in Melbourne, so despite the later start than usual, if he wins this in straight sets, it's not going to be hugely disruptive, is it, to his opening week? I know he's not going to be asleep probably until well after 3 o'clock in the morning, but I think if you know that Djokovic, that's in the budget. You know you're going to be asked to play at night on a fairly regular basis.
Yeah, without a doubt. And, you know, he has a routine. He likes to stick to it, as players do when they have had success at a particular tournament. And, I mean, it was just a superb set of tennis from at the moment. A tentative start, locked at 2 games apiece, but once he responded from love 40 down, it was really one-way traffic, heavy hitting from Novak, and as you say, you know, he would be prepared for scenarios such as this, getting onto the court a little later than normal. But as I saw his parents a little earlier, mentioned to them that I was calling this match and all should be going okay, and they agreed with me. They said, we hope so, we've only just arrived, we've got jet lag to deal with.
Well, the best thing they can do is stay up as late as possible, so maybe,
speaking from someone of experience,
four
Russell
sets, I know the way to try and conquer jet lag. Doesn't always
from
work
that side of the world,
but exactly, I know what we should be trying to do. Wins on the outside courts in the last few minutes for Ben Shelton of the United States, for Yulia Putintseva of Kazakhstan, who's won a good-looking first-round match against Sarana Kasteya, 6-3 in the deciding set. And there are a few other matches in progress which I will keep an eye on as Gigi takes over and brings you set number 2 with Woody here on Tennis Breakfast.
Thank you very much, Russ. Yes, we're all set. Novak Djokovic, his parents trying to stay awake, so if we do see them nodding off when there's a shot of them, we know the reason why, that it's jet lag. They just haven't seen too much tennis as cuts under the ball Djokovic, and he's being made to sprint to the back of the court. Kobayashi Baena has now changed to a sort of similar matching in shades of blue kit to Novak Djokovic, and that's one way, Woody, to test the leg of Djokovic, make him move backwards and forwards.
Yeah, and he seems a little confused. How on earth did he miss that final forehand? Looking at his racket, did it come off of the strings at all, Gigi?
No, I think it's just blaming the equipment, isn't it?
Blame your tools.
Just blame your tools. Just stare down at it. I couldn't possibly have got that wrong as he hooks the forehand, but Kobayashi Baena going long with the forehand. 45 minutes played. So what has he got to do differently, Woody, the Spaniard, in this second set to try and get something out of this match?
Well, one area, just looking at those stats from set one, Gigi, that the second serve points one for Kobayashi down below 30%. So
ouch.
Here we are at 15 all. He's missed the first serve. We'll see if the second serve stands up to the challenge.
Yeah, that's damaging, that kind of percentage of the serve. He gets the second serve in. Is he going to come through with the point? Djokovic slices cross court and deep, double-handed backhand bunted from Kobayashi Baena, who's on the stretch of the forehand. That's his squeaky shoes coming to a standstill at the back of the court. Djokovic inside the baseline. Djokovic pushed back behind the baseline, goes cross court with his forehand. A looping ball sits up, brought down through the middle by Djokovic. It's 15-0. Oof, that is a hammer blow of a forehand from the serve.
Yep. And look, this is another rally that we have seen several times tonight. Heavy ball striking from both the ends of the court. And as you said, Gigi, Novak just puts the hammer down on the final forehand, flattens that trajectory, a little bit more pace, and it's a winning shot.
There's a lady with a baseball cap with two Serbian flags sticking out either side. She's got a necklace made out of the Serbian colours around her neck and a t-shirt expressing her love for the nine-time champion who's been put on the back foot here as Kobayashi Baena puts away the overhead, wins the point, takes it to 30-all. But it's got to be that good for the Spaniard to be winning the point.
30-all. And is that a play? I like to see him explore going forward, but it's not necessarily a brand of tennis that he is overly comfortable with, Kobayashi. Ugh, just seeing a shot on camera, and I'm sure you're seeing the same, Gigi, of Mr. and Mrs. Djokovic. Oh, she's looking a bit fatigued. Was there a yawn there?
She was
rubbing her eyes.
And because sometimes, you know, tennis can be quite hypnotic. Sometimes, you know, you're following it left to right, right to left. And if they're feeling tired with jet lag, those eyelids could shut as Djokovic comes in, cuts under the ball, tries to go for the pass to Spaniard, and he misses. And Djokovic looking up to the heavens, thinking, what on earth is going on there? But it doesn't matter because he's got the breakpoint opportunity.
Yeah, it was looking towards the sky there after just tracking that ball. It did miss by a bit of a distance.
He's got an opportunity to get the early break to keep his parents awake, so you get a loud roar from the crowd, and if they fall asleep, that'll just suddenly wake them up. But it's into the net, and the break point is set. That's the hardest thing, isn't it? You know, when you're so tired and you're desperately trying to stay awake and you just can't. I mean, sometimes you just can't fight it and you fall asleep. But here they are with the cameras on them in their son's box.
Yes, they dare not fall asleep, otherwise Novak might be asking them to move from the box like he did last week, 2 weeks ago in Adelaide, asking his brother Marco to shift out of the box.
Tell you what, family
wasn't through fatigue, but perhaps it just wasn't enough support.
They get put through the ringer, don't they, families? But that was a lovely point from the Spaniard. He just had Djokovic on a string there, moving him to left and right, got the depth, won the point. But again, he mentioned how much he sweats. He's wiping, it's like a windscreen wiper effect with that sweatband sort of left to right on his forehead, and then he does like a figure of eight round his nose and mouth, and as soon as he's finished, he has to do it again. Points for the first game of the second set. listening to Tennis Breakfast. It's turned into Tennis Brunch, and that's a really good hold. He has to save a break point. A little fist pump for the Spaniard now, all in blue, and a slightly perplexed, I would say, Woody, annoyed look as the shaking of the head from Novak Djokovic.
Yep, beaten by a serve that was flat wide, catching Djokovic, and I think we saw that earlier in the first set, Gigi. He did turn around to Goran Ivanišević, his coach now for a couple of seasons, but it looked like he was motioning towards the different type of spin that Carbajos was imparting on the ball. Maybe not something that they had really planned for.
And I don't know if the boxes, the player boxes, have shrunk on the Rod Laver Arena, or the people in Djokovic's boxes are just big. They look, don't they look really squished in there? Do you know, they look like they've got absolutely no space?
I wouldn't be surprised if they have shrunk those boxes so that they could sell a few more seats to the public. Get some value.
Well, there you go. They've shoehorned in the Djokovic entourage. They're kind of knee-to-knee in the front row. Djokovic with that sort of wry smile on his face. He's not happy. He's slightly annoyed. As Carbajos Baena, I think he might get a wrist injury from all the wiping of the sweat he's doing on his face. Bouncing on his toes. He's got the first game of the second set under his belt. The world number 75. It's been as high as 71. That was last year. They have met before. That was US Open in 2019, first round. Djokovic came through in straight sets. Djokovic then 15 love. Kicks up that serve. And the backhand, not flattened out enough from Djokovic. That one a little bit flatter on the double hander. Coming out with a bit of venom on it. Oof, my word. They were two blistering backhands from the Spaniard.
They certainly were. And that's a dose of Djokovic's own medicine. Two backhands that were flat trajectory from Carbajos. 136 Ks, the final backhand winner.
And he's bouncing on his feet and just feels like we've had a little lull from Novak Djokovic. I say that as he aces out wide and the Spaniard doesn't even move. Djokovic puffs out his cheeks, gathers the balls from the back of the court, twiddles them in his left hand, tucks one in the left-hand pocket, bounces the one he's going to use with the face of the racket before he gets himself set and in position. A slightly hypnotic bouncing of the ball that he does. It does have the 25 seconds like everyone to get it away, but the serve doing what is there to do, winning him an easy point and bringing up game points. This is the second game of the second set, first set for Djokovic, and I'm keeping an eye on Kokkinakis Fanini, and it looks more than likely it's going to be Kokkinakis against Murray. 6-1, 6-2, 4-2, love 30 on the Fanini serve, and unfortunately for Murray, he wanted two players to go and beat each other up out there. It's about an hour and 30 that match, so Kokkinakis will be relatively fresh as Carbajos Baena goes back behind Djokovic to keep the game alive. 40-30.
Kokkinakis trying to avoid the first round defeat that he suffered last year, although he did arrive extremely fatigued, having won Adelaide, short turnaround, not enough time to prepare.
I'm going to say he's definitely going to avoid that this time around, because he's got points now for 5-2 in the third. And if he can get off court in a short amount of time as well, and he's playing against Murray, who was battered and bruised and barely walking when he left the Rod Laver Arena a few hours ago. And he's got the crowd. You'll have the home crowd for Kokkinakis. That's going to be a belter. Or on paper, it's exciting. The placement of the inside-out forehand for Djokovic. And he goes inside-out again. It's cut back by Carbajos Baena. It's back to the backhand of the Spaniard from Djokovic. The overhead from Djokovic. He takes his time. He keeps it in court. Back to the body of Djokovic. Right into the centre of the body. He couldn't control it, Djokovic. And again, you come back to that overhead. We talk about it being a weakness. He was very careful, wasn't he, Woody? He just placed that overhead back in court.
Yeah, there are times that Djokovic will just steer the overhead, tries to carve around the outside of the ball. And once he made the overhead, Gigi, he didn't really expect Carbajos to get the next shot as low over the net. It's like Djokovic was unaware that the ball was coming over.
Oh, he looks a bit moody today, doesn't he, Novak Djokovic? Cuse serve down the tee. Midcourt ball high, sits up, should put it away. Manages to get to it, Kabayan, but there's too much on that from Djokovic. So it's a game point. Very upright stance of Djokovic in that wiry frame as he gathers the three balls, discards one very quickly, tucks one in the pocket. The routine that he goes through. 55 minutes on the clock. Just gone 11:30 in the evening. Local time in Melbourne, so it's afternoon here in the UK on a Tuesday afternoon.
Game.
There's an ace, there's the point. He's still not happy, puffs out his cheeks, but he gets the game, and it is one game all in the second set.
And that strapped left quad or hamstring, I should say, of Djokovic is certainly getting a working over Gigi. The way that he does serve, obviously there's the weight as he bounces the ball that is leaning onto that front foot. And then after contact, he actually lands on that left leg as well. So he's absorbing a lot of his body weight onto it. And then we've seen him move towards the net. So it's getting a thorough test tonight.
And he needs to get this done in three. He can't be sort of engaging in some long, epic encounter out there for the sake of that left hamstring, you would have thought.
Well, I think ideally, yes, he would love to be able to scoot through this match in a short amount of time. Three sets, if possible. We've seen some lengthy rallies, but he's generally put an exclamation point to Djokovic by flattening the ball out and winning most of the longer rallies. The percentage for Karbayos when the rally is over nine shots, definitely a big plus for Djokovic.
Miss serve out wide from the 29-year-old Spaniard. Started playing tennis at the age of three. It wasn't tennis, it would be football, played a lot of football. And his idol, David Ferrer, a real fighter. That's the man he looked up to as he was growing up.
Well, that's one of the great sportsmen, David Ferrer. Boy, he was an athlete, someone that very rarely lost early in some of these majors, made his way through to his allotted spot in the draw. And it only took the very best to beat him in the majors.
Real terrier, wasn't he? A real fighter. So here we go.
I'm watching Karbayos, the way that he plays, Gigi. It's almost reminding me of an Australian player that is having an exceptional run at the moment, is Jason Kubler.
I saw him on the order of play for tomorrow. Would that be right?
Yes. Yeah, he won his first round yesterday in straight sets. Up tomorrow. It's a very similar game, striking the ball heavy from both sides of the court, of the forehand and backhand wing.
Overhead from Djokovic. Again, it's not put away. So he's got another one. This time he gets the angle on it, puts it away, gets on the board. Yeah, Jason Kubler faces Karen Khachanov tomorrow. That is the day session, not before 6 a.m. UK time on the John Cain Arena. Wildcarded into the Australian Open.
Yeah. Thanks to the results that he enjoyed late in the season.
I'm wondering if players have been suspended outside or they've just had a very long pause in the Kokkinakis-Fanini game because things haven't changed there in a good few minutes as Karbayos Baena holds pretty comfortably to lead by 2-1. And that's probably something that could start to annoy Djokovic, isn't it? If this game starts to drag a little bit, if the Spaniard starts to weave his way into this contest, if that hamstring is at all at the back of Djokovic's mind, which you'd expect it might be, that might just start to irritate him.
Yes. He's hanging around Karbayos. Still the early stages of this second set. Three games in. And an admirable effort so far. And this is almost to the same juncture of the first set, Gigi, where Djokovic came out and really put the foot on the pedal and just motored his way through. Picked up a break of serve and held convincingly.
Well, I can confirm it's rainy again. We got the roof on the Rod Laver Arena, but the rain. And did you say the forecast, Woody, for tomorrow? There's a lot of rain around tomorrow as well.
Yeah, there is, unfortunately, a huge temperature drop from the first 2 days, in particular today to tomorrow, at least a 10 to 15 degree drop. They're only expecting high 20s, but also forecast with showers tomorrow.
Oh, the sadness in your voice when you talk about the temperature drop to the high 20s. There is no sympathy coming from this end.
Oh boy, well, Melbourne, does its best. This is a real test of, they say four seasons in one day, and this is what we might have experienced today.
It was -3 when I came to work this morning, Woody. -3. When was the last time you experienced -3?
Never.
Because you largely reside in a very hot desert.
I do. Although, after the Australian Open finishes, I am on Davis Cup duty. I'll be heading to Budapest the tie between Hungary and
thermals.
France. Well, this is an issue because I didn't bring any cold clothing with me. I might have to.
Do you have any cold clothing? Do you ever go anywhere cold? Because the tennis tour follows the sun. You live in the desert.
It does, really,
you come
doesn't
from
it?
Australia. Yeah. Do you do you ever experience the cold apart from air conditioning?
But I do. I really enjoy the end of the year because for between weeks 40 to 45 is my time where I get to be in some of the European stops on the tour, and it can be a little chilly.
Oh dear. You better find some thermals for Budapest, because you are going to get a shock going from Melbourne to there. Wow.
Yes, I might have to.
I'm going to find out the
temperature. Do a little bit of shopping when I make a stop. But is there any recommendations for some stores in London? I might have to make a pit stop.
Just need get yourself to M&S and get yourself some Woolies and get yourself some thermals. That would be my suggestion. 15 love, 1-2. We did have the French Open that took place in October. That was very weird, seeing all the coaches wrapped up in sort of ski gear as these players move each other from side to side, but just wide from Djokovic. That was really unusual. I remember trying to identify coaches in the crowd, but they all had hats and scarves and winter jackets on. That was, for an outdoor tournament, that was a very, very strange sight.
It was in limited crowd numbers as well.
Yeah.
If I remember correctly. Yes. Although you were perched nicely in your studio.
Yes.
Not sure how many times that you got onto court Philippe Chatrier.
Whenever I could.
15:30.
7 p.m. though, that's when the show with Gigi began, yes?
Yes.
And I was conspicuously absent.
You kept turning down an invitation to come on the show. You would heckle from the sidelines, but you would refuse to come on the show because you always said you were very busy. Oh, I don't know. And just to tell
you,
in Budapest on Saturday, it's going to be snowing and -1 degree. So and it's going down to -2, so it's not building up heat anytime soon.
Oh gosh. Yeah. Earmuffs as well, probably, yes?
Oh, like a snood, earmuffs, thermals, big jacket, gloves. Yeah, I think you need an extra suitcase, you're gonna get a shock, I think. 30 all, we are on the fourth game of the second set. There's Djokovic with a second serve as the ball boy rushes forward to scoop up the loose ball. An hour and 4 minutes on the clock. Lots of bouncing going on from Djokovic. Kicks up the serve. Serve does its job. Tobias Baena looks towards his box with slight annoyance, and it's game point Djokovic.
Yeah, he wouldn't be happy to miss that second serve return. You expect the Spaniards to just consistently put the ball back into play. It was a free point for Djokovic. And wow, after missing that serve there, Gigi, just pulling up there, just hopping.
Is it going to be another twist in the tail of another trip to Australia for Novak Djokovic? Game point, kicks that serve up. It's in play, inside in with the forehand. He's got a point here for two all. The former world number one could go back to world number one with a title, which would be a 10th title. He slices, but doesn't get under that ball. It floats long, and it's juice. Yes. Tobias Baena's blue top is a different shade of blue because it's so soaked in sweat on the back and the front. He's vamosing himself a fair few times. I'm trying to think who the strange thing to think who the sweatiest players on the tour, and I think in this group has to, you have to put Borna Coric and you have to put Francis Tiafoe. I think they would probably be my top three. It's juice, and Djokovic is staying in one place. The ball is coming back to him. He has to move out to the side. He hits on the slide, the forehand. Now the double-handed backhand goes cross-court to the backhand. It's sort of bunted into the centre by Tobias Baena, who squash shot the Spaniard cross-court. Forehand cross-court. Oh, beauty of an angle from Djokovic. And he looks up at this. Ivan Ivanišević saying, yes, spread it wide, move it wide, find the angles. He did, and it's game point.
Advantage.
Well, lovely use of the angles. Novak, the forehand, short cross court, ball just landing inside the service box.
Oh, nearly in the semi-splits, Tobias Baena, as he was trying to stretch out wide. So another point to close out the game and make it 2-2. So bounces up, kicks up, just lands in for Tobias Baena, who goes back to the double-handed backhand of Djokovic, who swings into it, loses control of it, the Spaniard. That is the point of the game, so it is 2-2. You can see the kinesio tape just popping out from the bottom of the bandage on the left leg of Djokovic. So if you were doing, Woody, a sweat index, how would those three, would those three make your top three that I mentioned, or your top five?
Yeah, Borna most... would be in that list. I would add Carballos. I mentioned to Russell earlier that each time I have seen him play, and mostly it has been on the clay, I mean, his work rate is high, but I think he must have a new kit every week because of the sweat that his attire is usually drenched in.
Yeah, you can see it now as he goes to the drop shot. Oh, that was a lovely touch. But he gets it back, Djokovic, but in position, the Spaniard just to pop it back over, and he wins the point. Oh, that brought smiles from the Spaniard's box.
Oh, a little cat and mouse there on that final shot by Carballos. I think he was looking to go cross court, and the ball went down the line.
You know what? More hopping and a little bit of limping for Djokovic.
Yeah. Saw that, yes.
15, love. Backhand cross court. The backhand clips top of the net and slows down from Tobias Baena, who cuts under the ball and the slice. The slice from Djokovic. Oh, clips the top of the net, dribbles over. And he looks up as if to say, thank you, Lord. I've got a bit of luck. I needed that. I've won the point.
Oh, that was rude, wasn't it? That was an exceptional backhand slice by Carballos. Stayed extraordinarily low. Djokovic just sneaking over the net. Back to 15-all.
He's not the best of moods, Djokovic. He's obviously not at his most comfortable with that left leg. It's going to be an intriguing, if not day, tournament for Djokovic should he navigate this first round match. There's going to be a lot of questions in the press. He knows he's going to get the questions about the leg and how he's feeling. That is just going to build the intensity, the stress, the pressure. It's I don't know, Woody, it's going to be very interesting to see how this plays out.
Yeah, and just saying it's going okay is not good enough for most of the media that will be in that press conference. They want a number. Can you please give us a percentage? And you know, that's the turmoil, the difficulties that Djokovic must endure.
Yeah, they've got to carry out those press duties. There's a fine if they refuse, don't want to, don't go, or miss their press conference inside in. It rarely happens, every now and then, but rarely. Djokovic didn't move. He just swung at the backhand. He slaps his left thigh and the ball flies wide.
Crowded himself with the two-handed backhand. Usually he spaces himself nicely with the two-handed backhand. Not on that occasion.
So play suspended on the outside courts because the rain was falling once again. But wonderfully, due to the grooves that we have in place, it means we can play on. So what can I tell you? Casper Ruud is two sets up and on serve 2-1 in his match. Where's our other roof? Here it is. Alexei Popperin split sets was shown on the John Cain Arena. They are your three courts in action. Deary me. I don't know how your Serbian is, Woody, but a little word from Djokovic to his box. A couple of loose, uncharacteristic shots and game point for Spaniard.
Yes, I didn't quite pick up the language time that I spent with him over. It was a six-week crash course. Not retaining any of it. Yeah. Gosh, it took me 3 years of learning how to say yes and no in French.
Oh dear.
Learn anything in 6 weeks.
And no's quite an easy one. It's quite a global word. So it's just 6 weeks on yes. Good return of serve from Djokovic to the feet of the Spaniard for juice.
And that second serve not cutting away enough. The intent was to move Djokovic, and it was right in his wheelhouse. A strong return by Djokovic.
Juice to all, second set, both men in blue. One's kit stuck to them, soaked in sweat. The other's not quite so. One with heavy strapping on the left leg, the other with no strapping. Deep serve that kicks up and spins the inside-out forehand from Caballos Baena. The inside-out forehand. Again, that's the second of that inside-out that we've seen that's just sort of looped long. We saw the backhand to add into that. So three unforced errors in this game from Djokovic, and it's game point to the Spaniard.
Not missing by much. It had a decent trajectory from where we are sitting behind the court. Would have looked pretty decent, felt decent coming off of his racket.
Game point. First serve thunders off the top of the tape and back his own side. Djokovic's mouth slightly open, eyes looking down. Now they look across. Plays a double-handed backhand to the feet of the Spaniard, who scoops up that backhand down the line. Then backhand cross got the man who's making the noise is the Spaniard. The slice from the serve, the double-handed backhand cross court from Garbias Baen. It's loose again from Djokovic. There's another error. He stares towards his box. It's not a crisis. It's not a problem. It's just not that normal from him. So he stares across. And I'm going to use the word dramatic, but he does have a way, doesn't he, Woody? If he's not feeling entirely comfortable, Djokovic, and obviously something's bothering him, can be quite dramatic out on court.
Yeah, he gets those bulbous eyes, that glare that goes towards the box. I think he's a little fortunate, Gigi, actually, that he is playing Carbajos. And even though they are engaging in some lengthy rallies and he is having to move laterally across the court, it might be a little fortunate that he's not playing someone that takes time away from him, where he has to quickly make those sharp movements, where time is taken away from him. So he's able to build some rhythm on the baseline, but we have seen him just hesitate, pull up short, hop as a point finishes. Obviously, just still feeling that hammy out.
Russell, I would say, what have you been keeping an eye on? But the fact that it's rainy again where you are, not an awful lot outside of the three main courts.
No, and those who aren't under a roof are going home for the night, and that is going to frustrate two gentlemen in particular. One, Tanasi Kokkinakis, an extremely likely next opponent for Andy Murray, who's been thrashing Fabio Fognini. That's the good news for the Aussie. 6-1, 6-2, 4-2. Two break points for 5-2. Rain came down. Play suspended for the day on the Kia Arena, so he'll have to come back and finish off tomorrow. And the other man who was potentially very close to victory was Emil Ruusuvuori of Finland. Here's an Australian who may get a second win tomorrow, the qualifier Max Purcell. He was 2 sets to 1 down, and they're about to start a fourth set tiebreak when, again, the rain came down and play was suspended for the night on the outside court. Casper Ruud, 2 sets up and 2-all with Thomas Matschak of the Czech Republic on the Margaret Court Arena. And they're still playing in the John Cain Arena with Popperin and Tseng level at 1 set all. So that could yet be the latest finish of the night.
Djokovic just had a little root around in his bag at the change, Woody, and something wasn't there that should have been there. So he looks towards his boxes, but you know he has that little box of, is it dates? He takes a little nibble of. I think he's missing his dates.
Uh-oh. And was there a glare?
There was a glare and a sort of motion with the hand of, those things I eat are not where they should be. But I've just looked at his very packed box, and there's no one sort of leapt out of their seat to go and find them for him. So maybe they're just riding this wave of current discontent.
How's mum and dad looking?
They're still awake.
Get to see that shot. Are they still there?
They're still awake. Have you ever had that thing when you're really tired, you just sort of slap your face to wake yourself up? Have you ever done that?
I have. And sometimes in driving in the car, if you get that
excellent
sleepy feeling and quickly put the window down to have that fresh air.
It is the weirdest.
Blow on your face.
But it's the weirdest thing, though. You feel the eyes closing. Just give yourself a quick slap and think, that's the weirdest thing I've just done, is Djokovic double-handed backhand volley into the net. He looks as if he was going to leap up to hit that, but then just struck it down and into the net. No, but I haven't seen his parents slapping each other on the face to stay awake. But that is a tactic they might want to bring in if this goes long. Game points for 3-all. In the second set, Djokovic cuts the serve out wide and misses. The ball ricochets off the side, and then the ball boy thinks, well, I'm not going to get that. That's on your side of the court, so the other ball boy has to come out. Everyone's balls are in place, and Djokovic serves down the tee, and the backhand goes up the line, and Carl Bias-Baena puts a lot of spin on that, drops short, and sits up nicely for Novak Djokovic to close out for 3-all.
Seemed like Carbajos had made a decision to play most of that game, giving himself a bit more distance to pick up the ball. Maybe another foot or two behind the baseline. And whenever he does lose that weight of shot, the length of shot as well, Djokovic is so quick to jump on top of the ball, swipe that way for a winner. Gee, Goran. Certainly giving out some advice there, Gigi, after that game.
Yeah, I was thinking that. I mean, I know they're allowed to now, but he's very animated, isn't he? Giving out a lot of instructions.
Uh-oh. Sorry, the ball girl has lost her shoe right in front of our window here.
All right, well, that's never handy. We do, though, play on, and it's the backhand cross court to the backhand of Kabayas Baena, both of these men in their blue outfits going cross court. The backhand just got a little bit too low for the Spaniard into the net. Goes. Has she got her shoe back on?
Yes, she has. Seems like a little embarrassed. She seems a bit flushed and now shaking her head towards the chair umpire. Aurélie Tort.
Oh,
did I say that correctly?
Aurélie Tort. Yes.
Tort.
Tort. Can you say yes and no? Orange Walk from France.
Je pense.
It's not that confident, is it, if you only think you can? 15-all. I think the trainer is out for Casper Ruud's opponent. I'm not guessing, I did see him come out onto court. Casper Ruud in a good place right now in his match. 15 all, 3 all. I don't feel like we're talking about Casper Ruud, and maybe we should be, seeing as though what he did last year and where he is in the rankings, but a lot of the talk has been weighted on Djokovic and then Nadal, and then we had Kyrgios at the start, and not much chatter about the Norwegian as Djokovic goes inside in with his forehand, a forehand slap cross court, back through the middle goes the Spaniard, backhand cross court into the corner from the Spaniard, backhand cross court from the serve, the slice drops a little bit short from Kavaev, but he's been pushed so far back. Djokovic is camped inside the baseline. Djokovic on the slide. Oh, so low with the backhand. Djokovic steps forward with the forehand inside in. Hasn't won the point yet. Backhand cross court. Still the defence from the Spaniard. Drop shot from Djokovic. Here comes Kavaev Baena. He gets it. Here comes Djokovic. Can he finish it? Yes, he can.
And to their feet. The crowd, the supporters behind Djokovic. He's up winning that point, finally drawing Kyrgios into net. And that's an option open for Djokovic. And tremendous rally again, Gigi Kyrgios. So we're just retrieving. That's his type of game. He's very comfortable on the baseline, moving laterally, but the variation, there's no willingness to maybe explore coming forward that often, not maybe often enough. What a response after a heavy hitting rally. He sends down an ace.
Much needed. He'll be thinking the whole of the Djokovic box, barring mum and dad, were on their feet at the end of that point. Djokovic is having a little mutter. The trainer has now left Macek, who's facing Casper Ruud on the Margaret Court Arena. 30 all, 3 all. Oof! Boom! Another massive serve. Fourth ace for the Spaniard, matching Djokovic's total. Hour and 21 on the clock, another point here to keep his nose in front with serve and have the scoreboard lead at 4-3. Oof. That's nearly it. Third ace in a row, not to be out wide. Djokovic comes further forward up to the baseline. Tobias Baena serves to the backhand of Djokovic and then he spins the forehand, but it sits up midcourt nicely. Djokovic comes forward with the volley. He just pauses. He waits for the Spaniard to commit. He finds the open court and he keeps the game alive.
Nicely executed from Djokovic. The awareness, the recognition of when Kyrgios is playing a defensive one-handed backhand, in moves Djokovic. Option available for the Serb.
A little muttering from the Spaniard after that point. He had a game point, now it's juice. Thunders that first serve into the net. Ball boy scurries across and scoops up the loose ball under the roof on the Rod Laver Arena with play on the outside courts. Suspended for the day. Firstly, it was the heat and latterly, it was the rain.
Strong second serve again from Kyrgios. 174 Ks at second serve, and it is moving away from Djokovic.
Midnight has been struck in Melbourne. So we tick over into the early hours of Wednesday morning. Still very much Tuesday afternoon in the UK. Off the toes of Kyrgios Baena, who has a game point. Again, he carries on with his retrieval. He squash shots back. Djokovic camped inside the base, and way behind it is the Spaniard, who eventually nets, and the game continues.
Deuce.
Wow, it's still impressive by Kyrgios. Game duration is hitting 6 minutes. Easy to see why he is a tough competitor on the clay courts. Able to extend some of these rallies.
He looks around. Again, wipes the sweat away with that sweatband, settles himself. 3-all due, serve out wide, that should do the job. It does, it's another opportunity as he fist pumps towards his box. He's at his box's end to try and close out. Djokovic, is it? It's Djokovic. I think he's still looking for his dates. Point for 4-3. Djokovic edges towards the baseline. First serve, looking to go down the tee, found the net. Goes down the tee again. It's a lovely return and serve right in the wheelhouse of Djokovic.
Yeah, it was like he was ready for that spin coming from Carballos's serve. Just based himself nicely, easy power. Just too good.
Juice. Turning out to be a very important game. I know it's the seventh, I'm not saying every seventh game is important, but this one, it's got a little feeling about it now. Looks to keep his nose in front on serve, Carballos Baena, and Djokovic desperately wants the breakthrough, leads already by a set, whips the forehand cross court. Djokovic just moving the Spaniard around there. Djokovic goes drop shot. Oh, it scoops over, clips the top of the net, dribbles down the other side, and it's break point.
Lovely Djokovic touch, just brushing over the top of the tape, Gigi. And from that backhand wing, we normally see the backhand attempted drop shot in that same position of the court. Very rarely does he try the backhand drop shot that goes cross court, generally down the line.
Break point for 4-3. Carballos Baena misses the serve down the tee. He's got to get this second serve right. Anything short and Djokovic will pounce. Djokovic, wide stance, knees bent, eyes wide, hits the double-handed backhand, keeps his ground, plays the backhand Carballos Baena, and another backhand cross court, double-hander to double-hander, they go. Who mixes it up now? Who takes a chance? Djokovic redirects the backhand down the line, squash shot into the net, and there's the break. The point, the break, the almost grimace and the sort of wild exhilaration from the Djokovic fans in the crowd because he breaks for 4-3 in the second set, and that is the cue for the Djokovic fans to let their voices be heard. And what do you think we aren't and we don't talk about Casper Ruud enough? I just feel I haven't really spoken about him at all, and he's the second seed.
Yeah, no, Gigi, he has, I believe he's one of those few players that could end up being the number one ranked player. He lost, if I, from memory, first round last year, so
yep,
you know, he can certainly pick up a bunch of points, and I think it is dependent on the some other players that perhaps how deep they go, but he really could end up at the end of this Australian Open as the number one ranked player.
Yeah, there was a hand. Tsitsipas always seems to be in the mix to be world number one. Hasn't been, but he's always sort of, there's a permutation where it could work out for him. And as you mentioned, Casper Ruud could end up being number one. Carlos Alcaraz could still be number one. Novak Djokovic could go back to being number one. So it's a real sort of mix of who. Yeah. I just feel, I don't know, we just don't really, he just goes about his, but he does though. I don't understand, Woody, with clothing companies, don't they think about conditions and heat? Because on the face of it, black and lilac, I think it's quite a nice combination, but Ruud's got a black top and lilac shorts that aren't very good when it comes to sweat, should we say?
Well, we haven't been able to talk much about his form coming into the Open, given that he lost first round of Auckland, an unusual loss so early.
Yeah, it was. It's going to be interesting how these next 2 weeks shake out with the conditions, the various players, the niggles. We've had a handful of withdrawals from the men's and the women's side. Djokovic, the overwhelming, I would have put my house, possibly even my family, on Djokovic winning, but the hamstring, you know, how much does that change things? And if that does change things, it feels, it's interesting, it feels like if that does level things out, it doesn't necessarily mean, okay, it's not Djokovic, it's going to be Nadal. I feel if Djokovic is hampered, he's not the overwhelming favourite, then there's a few people in the running to win the title. Squash shot from Ceballos, Baena on the stretch, but it sits up mid-court. It's a high-driven forehand for Djokovic, an overhead for Djokovic. We kind of all hold our breath a little bit, but he nails that one and takes the point.
13.
One of those nice, easy overheads where you can transfer your weight going into the ball from back foot to front foot.
30 love, 4-3, looking for the consolidation. He feels a little bit more settled, Djokovic. There's just some little flickers of grey in the hair of Novak Djokovic. His is not a stress-free life at all times.
Aha. I'm sure you're getting the same pictures, Gigi.
Yes.
They're awake.
Dad's eyes are droopy. Dad's got heavy eyelids there, hasn't he?
Oh, so is Mum.
And the front three in the box, they're just too big to all sit together. they've got no room. They're just squished in there. But yes, Mum and Dad, we can confirm, although riddled with jet lag, are awake, as Djokovic, orally taught, confirming, has consolidated his break in the second set for a 5-3 lead.
And so that consolidation, that now there's plenty of scoreboard pressure on Ceballos. He's just shaking those legs of his, the Spaniard. He's had to do a lot of work, a lot of retrieving in this match.
And now he's serving to stay in the second set at 3-5, the 29-year-old, best Grand Slam result, third round at Roland Garros in 2020. Unsurprisingly, we've talked of his preference for the clay. Served down the tee, backhand through the middle of the court. The backhand swung cross court from Ceballos Baena, who had to stretch out and stick out an arm in a racket. He's on the back foot, as he is more often than not, as Djokovic comes forward, draws the error, and wins the point.
And nice move by Djokovic to finish the point up at net. But, now that he does have that scoreboard pressure on, it might be the opportune time for him to make his way towards the net on a few more occasions.
Another missed first serve from Ceballos Baena. An hour 32 on the match clock, coming up to 10 past midnight. Local time, 10 past 1 in the UK, as Djokovic with a forehand sweeps it cross court. It's a looping ball that sits up, flattened up down the line from Djokovic. Djokovic slices and floats that backhand in. The backhand sort of bunted down the line for Ceballos Baena, who goes backhand cross court. The Spaniard still with his double hander, scoops it up, sits up, backhand more sort of directional from Djokovic as he lasers it down. And the forehand netted from Djokovic. He's annoyed with himself.
59.
An error off that forehand side of Novak Djokovic. The ball seemed to have shot through, stayed a little lower on him. He's more unforced errors. Not that I'm saying it was an unforced error, Gigi, but I'm just highlighting the fact that he does have six more unforced errors than Ceballos, but significantly the ratio with winners much more favorable for Novak Djokovic.
Who is... or was, is 3 points away from the set, but Ceballos Baena is ahead in this game now, 30-15. We get a close call shot that no one's that interested in, so that's disappeared. Because we have the electronic line calling, no limbs to look out for at certain calls. Fault called out wide, clipped the top of the net, skewed it wide off the Spaniard's racket. Don't forget that tomorrow, not before 8 a.m, we'll have Emma Raducanu and Coco Gauff here on Sports Extra. If everything runs to time, that will start at 8 a.m. The back out's a beauty of a backhand from Caballos Baena.
Yeah, knowledge by Djokovic. Not so intent on trying to chase that ball down. That would have maybe, I could see him at times, Gigi, doing the splits on that one, that open stance and slice forehand of Djokovic, but perhaps protecting his hamstring. Not wanting to do the splits this time round.
Or ever, in my case. Gosh, wow.
Yeah, on a hard court. Who does that?
Who does that? He does that. Caballos Baena, he's sort of having a little chat to his box. We're largely ignoring him. And he holds serve, and he will ask the question. I mean, Novak Djokovic does have the break. And I guess, yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? If you are carrying an injury of some sorts, Woody, when you're out there, you're playing your game, you've got your game plan, but at the back of your mind, you're trying to protect that injury. So maybe pulling back or not extending yourself as you normally would.
Yep. I would say that the break of serve already being up 5-3 and just falling behind on that to last game and feeling good enough, confident enough to leave. Well, I don't have to chase that one down. I've got my serve to come. I haven't dropped serve in this match. I've only provided three break opportunities for Caballos, but my opponent hasn't taken any of the three options. Nice confidence to have, isn't it, Gigi?
Time.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Especially if you are protecting an injury or something that's not quite
yes.
right.
Yeah. And it's not like he has the service power of Goran Izavisevic, one of the most rhythmic and powerful and well-disguised serves that in the men's game.
Yeah.
Oh, wish I had one of those serves.
What, now or then or both?
I'll take it now. Yes.
No, but
oh, there's a beauty.
And just as we're talking about it.
I was just thinking about what a beauty of a serve. And there he does, play it out. Ace down the tee.
There it was. Caballos Baena bouncing around. Looks like a kind of tie-dyed top now with the sweat that the shade of blue has turned to a different shade of blue. Djokovic is all business, no smiling, no mucking around, just get this done and then go and answer the questions about your hamstring, because there'll be lots. Three points from closing out the set. Oh, wow, took a cut at that return of serve, the Spaniard. His way now to a two sets to love lead with triple set point. A shake of the head from the Spaniard. He has a little chatter with his box. His box kind of look in all directions but at him, and Djokovic head down, bouncing the ball. Thunders the ball into the net. For two sets to love lead for the 9-time champion. Djokovic, mid-court ball, swings the high backhand, scoops up the backhand, goes down the line. Squash shot from Caballos Baena, the forehand down the line from Djokovic, into the net from the Spaniard. And there's a little look to the box and saying, I am getting the job done. That's what he needs to do. We talked about this with Iga Świątek. We talked about this with Ons Jabeur. Get the job done. Get through it. They will build momentum. They have more gears to go through. And that, you feel exactly what Djokovic is doing here, Mark Woodford. He is getting the job done.
Yep. And it's certainly not his one of his more premium matches, but it is playing well enough, getting the job done. Good amount of first serves into play, has a high win rate of 83% when that first serve lands, and it's not doing so badly either behind the second serves. But you know, his ability to find the open court, Gigi, in set number two, a balance between winners and unforced errors, much more favorable for Novak Djokovic. 56 minutes and sits down with a two sets to love lead.
Yeah, he certainly does. Right, we're gonna hear from Ons Jabeur in a second, but just to give you the headlines of the day, as the music plays out around the arena and the highlights you can hear in the background, play suspended on the outside courts, initially due to the heat and latterly because of the rain. But Casper Ruud is out and the second seed is going about his business. He's two sets up and it's 5-1 against Machak. Now, the big news from a British point of view is Andy Murray beat Matteo Berrettini in absolute epic 4 hours and 49 minutes, coming through in the first to 10 point tiebreak in the fifth. He was bloody battered and bruised, but made his way through. Also coming through was Dan Evans, a big win for Sasha Zverev, who's still on that comeback trail from injury, coming through in five sets against the lucky loser Varillas, and a really good performance from Belinda Bencic. She is in the Ons Jabeur half of the draw. And she made it tough on Jabeur a little bit earlier. She was frustrated out there. There was lots of negative body language, but she came through in the end in her match earlier today, which you heard live on Sports Extra, against Tamara Zidancic, 7-6, 4-6, 6-1. And as we've been talking about, it's about getting through these first rounds for everybody in the draw. It's exactly what she did. We might be able to hear from her later, but in the meantime, let's get back to your commentary. The start of the third set on the Rod Laver Arena. Russell Woody is going to entertain you with his language skills, I'm sure, at some point during this third set as we settle back to enjoy.
Je pense was impressive, I thought, in the last set.
Oh, that was it.
I didn't miss anything then.
6-3, 6-4. Novak Djokovic has won the first couple of sets, but it's been competitive. It's been a proper tussle. And he'll be very, very keen to get this one done in straight sets. He's won the first point against the Roberto Carballes serve at the beginning of this third set. 18 minutes past midnight. So given the rain on the outside courts now, which has called play off for the final time there tonight, he and Casper Ruud are battling, along with actually Alexei Popperin and Seng Chun-Shin, who are on the John Cain Arena, to see who's going to be the last one out there tonight. Forehand from Djokovic to the forehand of Carballes Baena, who's now hitting a backhand cross court. Slice backhand from Djokovic. Another slice backhand from Djokovic onto the slice backhand of the Spaniard. Slice down the line on the backhand by Djokovic. Lovely rally to watch this. And then Djokovic hits the backhand down the line, flattening it out a little bit and finding the mark and pumping his fist, because here's an early opportunity in the third set at love 30 on the Carballes serve.
Just on our screens, Russell, that backhand slice, when it hit the ground, it ended up just moving further away from Carballes. Didn't get a clean strike at the ball, and Djokovic just nailed that backhand up the line.
Love 30 down. Carballes. Good junior career he had. Top 10 in the world. Reached the semi-finals here in Melbourne in the boys' singles in 2011. Putting a first serve into the net. And he's had a crack at Novak Djokovic before at a Grand Slam in the US Open first round of 2019. Onto the baseline goes Carballes. A backhand from Djokovic to the forehand of Carballes. Djokovic down the line with the forehand, and that's into the net on the backhand by Carballes. And these are three break points for Novak Djokovic in the opening game of the third set. He won that first round US Open match in straight sets, Djokovic, and he's poised to do exactly the same thing here tonight, or this morning as it is now, in Melbourne.
three break opportunities. Wouldn't be surprised to see Djokovic try and maneuver his way to net on one of these break opportunities. Certainly now when he has a second serve to return.
Second serve for him now. Backhand reply, Djokovic. Forehand nicely picked up by Carbeas, but Djokovic looks very confident at the moment. He's flowing beautifully. He's coming in towards the net. There's the backhand volley. And it's a two-set advantage to Djokovic. And he has the break now in the opening game of the third.
And it's like playing the point and the flow of the match correctly there. Two sets to love lead and sprinted out to a 40 love. Why not try and move towards net and finish the point quickly?
So how anxious are you about that leg? I know you and Gigi were feeling you were noticing a slight deterioration in that second set.
Well, deterioration or protection perhaps. It seemed like that when he landed a number of times on the left leg, it just was painful. I used to be susceptible to myself, Russell, to an adductor, being left-handed, and used to anchor my left leg out. And it's one of those that when you go to put your weight on it and you feel it giving away and you just want to pull up immediately. And it's a similar reaction, it seems, with Djokovic,
who serves an ace.
And I think that he ideally would want to try and get through this third set now. You know, it's almost like he has broken this match wide open. Not sure of the interest level of Carbeas.
Another ace for Djokovic. So the only way, presumably, for it to clear up entirely is just to stop playing for a week or so.
Well, this match will still be there tomorrow, most certainly. It will be there in the next match that he plays.
That's three aces in a row from Djokovic.
Lovely serving. But yes, I think for the first week, Russell, he is just going to have to play with this niggle.
Can he produce the perfect game? Down the tee he goes. Carbeas gets a racket on the board. You spoil sport. Couldn't make the service return, but he's prevented Novak Djokovic constructing the perfect service game. Three aces and a service winner. He's won the first 8 points of this third set. And he leads by two sets to love and two games to love. So the golden set is still on.
When was the last time we had a golden set?
Well, the one I remember was at Wimbledon, and that was a long, long time ago now. And I always knew exactly who it was. And I can't remember the name now. Oh, terrible.
I know.
I'm going to find out.
It's after midnight.
It's on the tip of my tongue. It's around about 10, 12 years ago, I think. Into the net with a forehand. Carbeas Baena. So he's lost the first 9 points of this set now. Yaroslava Shvedova. That's right. At Wimbledon. Forehand hit by Djokovic. Super aggressive at the moment. He's got another short ball. The backhand from the Spaniard. Forehand volley is a good one from Djokovic, but he needs to make a second one, which he does very securely. 10 points in a row, the serve flags are flying again. According to the WTA, that golden set in 2012, as of 3 years ago, by Yaroslava Shvedova, was the only time in the Open era that has been achieved, against Sara Errani. Twenty-four points in a row.
Nice.
Novak Djokovic has 10 in a row.
Well, I think it could be 14 points in a row.
If you include the end of last set.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Three straight love games. Love 30 now for Carballos.
He serves into the net. At what point do you start thinking about it if you're a player? Or have you actually forgotten that you've not won a point so far in the set? Forehand return Djokovic, forehand Carballos, forehand Djokovic, forehand Carballos, Djokovic with the forehand, backhand by Carballos. Djokovic is really loosening up now and hitting so freely. Forehand cross court, the passing attempt long by Carballos. So little he could do there. Djokovic in complete control, and these are three further break points for a three love lead.
And that's ability to take time away from his opponent. It's not just the pace of shot, but Djokovic, great job of positioning himself a little closer to the baseline. And it's almost like it pushes Carballos back, maybe an extra foot or two, and really under a lot of pressure right now. Love 40.
Backhand return is wide, so the golden set is no more. Not even half a golden set. But he did win the first 11 points, Novak Djokovic. Still two more break points. More importantly for him to move three love up, a double break up in this third set, and signal a swift conclusion to this match. And it seems a long time ago that you were struggling to find the Bond store on South Bank in Melbourne for our 5 Live tennis at 8 o'clock in the morning, 9 o'clock last night on 5 Live. Carballos stretching for the backhand, forehand volley Djokovic. Wasn't that just wonderful? Lovely touch by Djokovic, caressing that forehand cross-court volley and breaking again and leading by 3 games to love. So how many coffees did you end up drinking this morning? Because while we were on air, you had a couple. They were lattes, to be fair. And then yes, you were meeting another friend for breakfast afterwards.
And I had another 2. And then when I got back to the hotel, I had another 1.
So that was 5 before you even arrived on site?
5 before midday.
Is that normal?
No. I just needed to have that Java injection so that I could operate.
Did you notice a difference?
Did you notice a difference? Maybe.
Are you performing better? Are you livelier than you normally would be at this time of the night? I don't think so. You're always fairly chipper. You always seem to have a lot of energy.
Thank you. It's the company that I keep. And the joy I take of watching one Novak Djokovic and tightening the screws here completely on Carballos Baena. Seems like Djokovic is cruising to an easier third set than the first two.
And he's played well.
He's picked up. It's like he's gone on a burst that arrived in the first set, didn't arrive until the latter stages of set two, but it is a purple patch right now.
Another winner by Djokovic. So 6-3, 6-4, 3 love, and now 15 love. We have the completed schedule for tomorrow now. It's taken until nearly 12:30 midnight for it to be produced, and I appreciate it's been a trying day for the organisers with matches only called off finally for the day about an hour or so ago, but a lot of players wondering when they'd be playing have only just been informed. That's long by Carballos Baena. There's just no answer to the way Novak Djokovic is playing at the moment. And I see that Cameron Norrie will be last on the Kia Arena. So he's actually the 5th match, although the 2nd match is the conclusion of Kokkinakis against Fognini, which may only last 5 points. Ace from Djokovic to 40 love. He'll be up against Constant Lestienne of France, and that's quite handy from our point of view.
Well,
because
hopefully
we're on the air with Emma Raducanu against Coco Gauff as one of our commentary matches on Tennis Breakfast from 7 a.m.
Well, I'm sure Cam Norrie hope that it isn't a constant list, yeah.
He wants him to be
Inconsistent.
Inconsistent as opposed to constant. Breaking up. That's what he's hoping for. Backhand into the net by Djokovic. That's the first point he's conceded on serve in this set. 3-love, 40-15. Quite a lot of rain forecast daytime tomorrow, so I suspect there's every chance Cameron Norrie will not play his second round match until Thursday. Maybe one of the lucky ones, but there's certainly a forecast of quite persistent rain. May not be particularly heavy as Djokovic comes to the net and puts a backhand volley away, which could mean he's got a frustrating day hanging around the locker room. Four love Djokovic. Two games away from victory. The Rod Laver Arena night session. Emma Raducanu against Coco Gauff. And then Stefanos Tsitsipas against
Rinky Dink.
Rinky Hijikata of Australia.
Boy, had that enthusiastic. Did you see him respond in his match from two sets to love down?
Yeah.
Coming back to first win round. He was in a frenzy for at least two full sets as he was drawing level to two sets apiece and then tried to continue that momentum in to the fifth.
Good serve by Carbajes. Djokovic cannot make the forehand return. Yeah, got a good bit of coverage that here in Australia. As did earlier today, and it seems a long time ago now, Kimberly Birrell, the world number 167, who's had so many injury problems, beating the formidable Kaya Kanepi. She's got such a great Grand Slam record, 7 Grand Slam quarterfinals in 3 sets, after Kanepi served for a straight sets win. Forehand, hit there by Carbajes to the Djokovic forehand. Forehand from Djokovic, which just brushes the tape, and he apologizes by raising both his arms, because it's contributed to him winning yet another point and moving to 15 all on the Spaniard serve. Playing overnight tonight, and we'll have news of these matches in Tennis Breakfast. Iga Swiatek against Camille Osorio, Jessica Pegula against Alexandra Sasnovich, and Rafael Nadal, Mackenzie McDonald. Those are the Rod Laver Arena day session or night session matches for those of you in the UK. Lovely backhand down the line by Djokovic. And this is looking very straightforward. He's making it look easy.
So what's your opinion? Is it Djokovic that has raised his level and is just accelerating away? Or is it Carbajes that's probably dropped 5%?
I think he's tiring a little bit and belief is fading. I think it's like with a lot of sport, isn't it, where you perhaps see in a game of football or rugby union's perhaps a good example, where a team in defence soak up a lot of pressure and then in the last 20 minutes or so the superior team really make their superiority felt. Another forehand winner from Djokovic. Two more break points now for a 5-love lead in this third set.
And he was bothering Djokovic in the second set. He was keeping his nose in front. Carbajes was being very annoying for Djokovic, and then once the break of serve arrived to go up 4-3, it has been one-way traffic for the number 4 seed.
Two more break points for Djokovic. Forehand return, right back at the feet of Carbajes Baena. A slice backhand approach by Djokovic. Forehand from him now into the tape. Second break point coming up. Oh, Casper Ruud is not going to be a happy man. The second seed has just dropped the third set on a tiebreak, 7-5 to Tomas Machak of the Czech Republic. They just started a fourth set at 1:25 in the morning. Forehand return from Djokovic. What a winner. On the move, out wide to his forehand. He just timed it magnificently well.
a forehand winner, and he just continued in the direction of his chair, because it's time for another change of ends. And Djokovic, who's conceded only 4 points in this set so far, so he's won 16 out of 20 points. In fact, 20 out of 24 points. He's a game away from victory, leading by 5 games to love. And he looks like he's going to round things off in style here on the Rod Laver Arena. What an eventful day it's been, with wins earlier in the day for the likes of Aryna Sabalenka and Caroline Garcia and Leila Fernandez and Andre Rublev in a match against Dominic Thiem. And then the big story of the day, other than the weather, the 37 degree heat which caused a 3-hour suspension in play, Andy Murray, 2 sets to love up against Matteo Berrettini, still had the presence of mind, the strength and the form to win a first to 10 point tiebreak and close out the match in 4 hours and 49 minutes to take his place in the second round. Since then, we've seen Ons Jabeur win despite dropping a set against Tamara Zidancic. She did win the decider by 6 games to 1. Belinda Bencic has had another fine win. Alex Diminor has won for Australia, and Alex Zverev has got his first win since the quarterfinals of the French Open after the ankle ligament damage he did in the semi against Nadal. Surgery followed, a couple of defeats in the United Cup for Germany, but he got through just in 5 sets against the Peruvian lucky loser Juan Pablo Barrias earlier today. Here's Novak Djokovic serving for a straight sets victory on his return to Melbourne Park, and there's a backhand. Inch perfect just inside the baseline. 6-3, 6-4, 5-love, and now 15-love. The other news to bring you, a win for Dan Evans in 4 sets against Facundo Bagnis of Argentina. He had a 3-hour wait, chance for a cold shower in the middle of that match because of the suspension of play. Another point to Djokovic.
He's just poured cold water on this match. It was pretty heated for 2 sets, but now Djokovic dominating.
Super fast conclusion to this match, it would appear. Backhand return from Carbeas. Another forehand from him now. Cross court he goes, slice backhand Djokovic, backhand cross court from Carbeas, Djokovic with the slice backhand, back into position in the middle of the court on the baseline, and it's a forehand down the line, and he's really finding all the right shots in this set, which is going to be the final set of the match. Goran Ivanišević has a pleased look on his face. 3 match points for Novak Djokovic to win the final set by 6 games to love. He serves into the net. Second serve. Match point number one for Djokovic. Forehand return from Carbeas is into the net. Novak Djokovic back on the Rod Laver Arena. Does not fluff his lines at all. A wonderful ovation for him. Almost 12 months to the day since he was deported on a flight out of Melbourne on the eve of the championships, having lost his appeal to stay in the country. And now just soaking up the adulation from this Rod Laver Arena crowd. He's won 6-3, 6-4, 6-love against Roberto Carbeas Baena. And in that final set, Gigi, he's allowed the Spaniard just 4 points, 24 to him, 4 to Carbeas Baena. And in the end, a very routine victory as we anticipated, and no obvious signs of a major physical issue with that tightly strapped hamstring.
No, there's a little bit of limping in the second set. He pulled up a couple of times on that left leg in the second set. He didn't look happy, he looked annoyed. It's amazing how the switch was flicked as Roberto Carbeas Baena waves to the Rod Laver Arena crowd. It is, what time is it with you, 12:40 So it's into Wednesday morning and the Spaniard leaves the court and will be heading, I'm sure, very soon back to his favoured clay. But there will be a lot of questions, won't there, about the hamstring in his post-match press conference. That will be the question that's asked because it's strapping that we're not used to seeing on Novak Djokovic. But, Woody, we talked about this during the match. He will be delighted, Djokovic, to have got off that court in straight sets.
Absolutely. It wasn't looking that way midway through that second set. Cabellos was doing a pretty good job of annoying Novak. He wasn't able to break free. But once those shackles were snapped, Novak cleared out very quickly. I think he'd be pretty happy to end that third set without losing a particular, well, any game. Four. I'm just looking at my notes here, Gigi. I think four of the six games were love games for Novak.
Well, let's hear from the nine-time champion. Speaking
Novak,
now.
Novak, congratulations and a very warm welcome back. But 22 matches in a row here at Melbourne Park. Why do you love it here so much?
Unbelievable atmosphere. Thank you so much for staying this late, everybody. Also, thank you for giving me such welcoming and reception I could only dream of. I really feel very happy that that I'm back in Australia and I'm back here on the court where I had the biggest success in my career. You know, definitely this court is the most special court in my life and couldn't ask for a better start of the tournament. So thank you for your support. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
What is it and why do you love it? I mean, you seem unbeatable at the moment with that form. That was simply impressive tonight.
Well, I guess the more you win on a certain court, the more comfortable and confident you feel every next time you step on it. That's probably one of the reasons, you know, I've had been fortunate to win a lot of matches on this court, particularly in the night sessions. And, you know, if I have to choose one court and conditions, it would be night session on the Rod Laver Arena all night long, you know, definitely.
Absolutely. I mean, what we witnessed tonight, just tactically, you were ultra aggressive. Was that something you were going to see this year? But boy, that was some ball striking right from the start all the way through.
Well, I'm very, very pleased with the way I played in the third set. You know, didn't give him too much chance to breathe from back of the court and served very well. You know, second set was kind of going up and down, but credit to him for fighting. He's a great guy. You know, we train a lot in Spain and it was his first match on Rod Laver, so he deserves a big round of applause for his performance.
Novak, so great to have you back and such a warm reception tonight. Just want to say that was some performance tonight. We wish you all the best moving forward. And if you can bring that sort of form, you're going to be very hard to beat. That was a great performance.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And I just want to say I love my parents and my brother. My parents and my brother are here, you know, after 15 years. They've been here last time when I won in 2008, my first slam, so hopefully they bring me luck once again.
It's looking very good. Ladies and gentlemen, Novak Djokovic into the second round.
His parents, though, they've got those little tired eyes, you know, sleepy eyes, when your eyes start to shrink because they've got jet lag. But, Woody, they lasted. They didn't fall asleep during the match, and they're there to see their son come through and reach yet another Australian Open second round.
I thought I saw a yawn or two there, and the camera really beamed on them, and they gave themselves a bit of a slap. I think they used your theory, Gigi. No, they were excited. You know, they've been great supporters of Novak, and obviously, you know, to arrive here for his first round, and you know, just trying to put aside from what has happened in the last 12 months and you know, hoping that they will be here the entire 2 weeks.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And what if you were giving this performance a mark out of 10, Woody, what would it be?
I give it a 7 out of
solid,
10.
Yeah.
I mean, got it. Yep, solid. Give room to improve. And, you know, there were some signs. And I don't think that even in the next round, Gigi and Russell, that, you know, he's going to be, you know, tested. I think it's almost a similar type of player, regardless of who it is. That match is still to be played. But I don't think they're of the caliber that would cause a major upset. So, you know, perhaps this is the real, you know, test for Novak, just to get out here, manage that hamstring. I think he will manage it in the next round, and perhaps by the third or fourth round, you know, he might have overcome this niggle.
Well, the sort of players he may face could be Grigor Dimitrov in the third round, could be Pablo Carreño Busta in the fourth round, could be Andrei Rublev in the quarterfinal.
Yeah, he'd want that to be gone by the time he arrives at the third round, I would expect.
Yeah, but there are, if he's fit, those are all players that, in his prime, and he still looks like he's very much in his prime, he's going to be pretty confident of beating.
Well, Dimitrov is a player that, if he's on and if he's willing to tactically play smart, take time away from Novak and give him less time to actually recover from the corners. Tonight, he was given that space, and he wasn't really tested quickly off the mark. And again, whomever he faces in the second round, they're not players that will be aggressive and attack the net as much as, say, potentially Grigor Dimitrov will.